So, when I first stole this show from Dan, I did a quick little fold of Kanye West's All of the Lights. And while that episode kinda sucked, I wanna take a stab at music videos again. So let's take a look at those late 90s music videos that I keep mentioning.
You've got mail.
Okay, starting early again. Dear foldable human, what about Transformers? Where's the link to Transformers? You forgot to do a stupid bridge again last episode. Stop being stupid. Trevor. Okay, last episode was about robots, and Rain Maida was replaced by a songwriting robot while they were writing Spiritual Machines. Zing! Alright, let's get started with...
You've got mail!
Delete.
You've got mail!
Delete.
You've got mail!
Delete.
You've got mail!
Alright. Transformers, old and new, and music videos are both narrative media created specifically to advertise and thus sell a product. So let's talk about it. So, the music video. I don't really have time or space to tackle the medium as a whole, and even doing so would seriously undercut a lot of the stuff that I want to talk about in the future, so I'm going to narrow it down to a relatively small sliver of the medium as a whole. The examples that I'll be using here are all going to be limited to 1996 through 2000. Also, a lot of the examples I'll be using are Canadian bands, so rest assured that I'm not scraping down at the bottom of the hipster barrel just to make a point here. Everything I'll be showing did chart fairly well. The reason I feel it's important to mention that is that I want to make a point about public consciousness, that the motifs and themes that run through these samples aren't just a one-off trend that I'm constructing by digging through everything ever. I had more than enough samples to justify my point when I initially limited my search to only Billboard Top 100 hits from 1997. This was a significant trend in popular culture, but it's one that probably went unnoticed at the time for a variety of reasons. Now, the first response I'm expecting is that someone's going to say, "You're reading too much into it," and we'll talk about that a little later. Enough mouth flapping, let's look at some samples.
My life is a stereo. How loud does it go?
You haven't seen the world inside the days you sleep, you hope, you wait.
Everybody's hard. Everything is automatic.
You just made up virtual insanity now. Always seem to gather about this love we have.
The first trend is a rise in technology as a central conflict of the story. This one makes a lot of sense as an extension of public thought because, in the latter half of the 90s, civilization was being caught in a huge wave of change towards the computer and internet world that we now live in. The whole notion started in the late 70s, but for the most part it wasn't until the early to mid 90s that the average household even thought about owning a computer, and it wasn't until Windows 95 exploded onto the scene that navigating a computer seemed like something a normal person could manage. On the entertainment side, a huge deal had been made over the dinosaur animations in Jurassic Park and how they were made with computers. To the normal public, animation looked like this.
Come on!
So this might as well have been made by wizards. Even music was being made by computers. Stack on top of that the impending Y2K bug that started making headlines in 96, and it seemed like this computer you had just bought last year was already about to destroy your civilization. It was like that T-Rex was a manifestation of technology chasing down conventional gas-powered civilization to chew it up and spit it out. It's no real surprise then that these themes started to crop up in music and music videos in 96 and 97. Now, in general, man versus technology is as old as technology itself. But for the most part, it's largely been alarmist or speculative, more sci-fi than fact. But look at that T-Rex again. Even now in 2011, that thing looks damn amazing. New industries were being created, jobs that hadn't existed 6 months earlier were suddenly in demand everywhere, and in tons of industries the old way of doing things was toppled overnight. These weren't specialized, expensive manufacturing robots that had to be completely overhauled just to make them attach a rivet instead of welding a joint. These were machines that anyone could bring home. Add on to this already heaping pile of change the rise of the internet, and there was something very real underneath society, waiting to explode. Everyone knew it was there, but no one could guess how big it would really be. Now, I played four samples earlier, but two of them stand out as the best examples of this, and they both fold into my next point. The first is Stereo by The Watchmen.
My life is stereo, kinda cheaply made though. How bad does it show? Whatever did become of all my friends? Whatever happened to the likes of all of you?
This one's a standout because both the song and the video are centered around this conflict, the sense of unease and hostility that comes with rapid progress, and the fear that will be swallowed up in it. The song itself uses the life of an old discarded stereo as a metaphor for abandonment and emotional impotence, and in the video, an ultra-modern office building somewhat reminiscent of Gattaca descends into chaos as the phones, escalators, and security systems stop working.
I'm so afraid of
The second is Virtual Insanity by Jamiroquai. The song itself is entirely about technology dismantling the future with altered food, destroyed ecosystems, and genetic tampering. These ideas all fold into the second point that I want to make, and that's a visual motif that was extremely prominent during this time frame. In the video for Virtual Insanity, JK drifts around the empty alien room alone. Sure, there's his band members there, but they're blown away down the hall, and he's left to dance around his trippy dream world in isolation. This motif of isolation was everywhere.
Throw away the radio, suitcase keeps you awake. Hide the telephone, telephone in case you realize that sometimes you're just not okay.
Now I'm guilt-stricken, sobbing with my head on the floor. Stopping baby's breath and a shoe full of rice. No, can't be held responsible.
I don't listen hard, don't pay attention to the distance that you're running, to anyone, anywhere. I don't understand if you really care. I'm only hearing negatives. No, 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 no.
Hanging around downtown by myself, and I had so much time to sit down and think about myself. And then there she was, driving back to her apartment. For the moment we're alone. Yeah, she's alone and I'm alone. Now I know it. She's a breaking up, drowning slowly off the coast, and I'm headed nowhere. I feel like a star.
Staunched and bottled, pressed and altered, and at the ready for the rains.
Everyone was depicted as being alone, out to sea, in the dark, distant from their peers, trapped in a room, or otherwise disconnected from the outside world. Sheryl Crow is in a display case, David Usher is sewing stars into a blanket, Brian Vander Ark is alone in the dark, Edwin is trapped at the top of a lamppost, this kid is drowning in his room, these kids are being spied on by scientists, and in more than one video, all the people have disappeared.
Nobody changes.
changes, won't see them tonight.
Now, I'm not going to suggest that people never felt isolated before 1996 or after 2000, but something in that time period made it really in vogue. This is a good time to go back
to
what's probably written in there. Dear foldable human, you're thinking into this too much. It just looks cool. All right, yeah, that's exactly what I was expecting. Okay, there's a bunch of reasons for why these videos end up this way. Some are intentional and some are unintentional, so let's run through a few. On the intentional side of things, you have to think about target market. Remember, these videos are being made to sell music to people, mostly teenagers and young adults. A lot of teens in the late 90s had already had contact with computers, either through things like Nintendo or their school, so the ballooning technology was something that made sense to them. But they were surrounded by adults who were trepidatious, or just flat out knew less than them about computers. Teenagers have felt isolated from adults pretty much as long as teenagers have existed, but that feeling was exaggerated by the unique language that teens had and adults didn't. One of the most painful interviews I ever saw involved middle-aged adults trying to explain the meaning of the title Garbage 2.0. So, to appeal to a target market that feels isolated, you create an image that resonates with those feelings. This is pretty obvious with a video like The Verve Pipe's Freshman or Ben Fold 5's Brick, which are both about feeling isolated and alone.
I cannot believe we'd ever die for these sins. We were merely freshmen.
Moving towards unintentional is the basic way that the band is portrayed in relation to each other and the audience. In a rock band, you have guitars, mic stands, a drum kit, wires, amps, pedals, and all those other things that get between the band and the audience and each other, dividing the physical space in a very real and visual way. I say that this is moving towards unintentional because it's entirely possible to make music videos where the band has no instruments at all, and there's no need for any of the instruments to be plugged in because they're not recording the sound that you're hearing at the same time as they're recording the video. This means that somewhere along the line, someone decided they wanted the band to hold their instruments and plug in all their gear and stick it on stage. This is pretty easy to illustrate.
Nobody ever knew. Doesn't anybody ever know?
The bands are all divided by clutter, while the pop musicians are synchronized with dance routines and standing 5 feet away from their adoring fans on the same level. At a basic level, it's about isolation versus community. The pop musicians are in the crowd, they're with the people, while the musicians are separated from them. On the almost entirely unintentional side is complete logistics. It's generally just easier to deal with the band without needing to wrangle extras or actors, not to mention it's cheaper. This compounds when the band is just one person, and you can confine the whole thing to one set. Now you, like Trevor, might be wondering if I'm overthinking this or looking at it in ways that weren't intended. No, I'm not. Here's the thing. With all media, there's already a gulf between intent, product, and the audience's interpretation. An artist's personal intent is often sideline information at best, and as time passes, that information fades into trivia, if not oblivion. Original intent becomes irrelevant over time as eventually only audience remains. In this regard, context can be useful and enriching, but a piece of art needs to stand on its own or be forgotten. And when it comes to something like cost, which is generally invisible to the audience anyway, everyone's eager to blame a low budget when something sucks, but no one really wants to mention how cost-effective their beautifully melancholy story of longing was.
Thank you.
Now, the last point is that it just looks cool. Some people, like Trevor, use this as an excuse to dismiss analysis, saying that it wasn't just unintended, it was actually for completely different reasons. In my mind, though, that honestly makes something more valuable for unfolding, because it tells us about our subconscious. Doing something because we think it looks cool is a good indication of what our values are at our core, or what's secretly eating us up inside. Alright, we're going to continue this discussion of conscious versus unconscious art next week with a look at something very... very Bowie.
You kicked my foot under the table. I can't.